Let's dive into five simple DIY gut health tests that you can do right now for free and without leaving the house to get a glimpse into the state of your gut's well-being. My name is Bella, and if you're new here, I'm a functional nutritionist and the founder of the Functional Gut Health Clinic, where we help clients overcome GI symptoms and take back control of their gut health. Test, don't guess is one of our favorite sayings in the functional health space. And because proper functional testing can be expensive, you might want to make sure that you've done the basics first and really need to go down that path before spending money on more advanced labs. So in this video, we'll explore some easy DIY tests to assess your gut health, which can give you clues about your digestive health and whether you might need more comprehensive testing. We all love quick, free and easy, but you might be wondering, can these DIY tests really give me useful insights into my gut health? How hard are they to complete? And most importantly, what can I do with the results? Stay tuned as we're going to explore these questions, discuss each of the five DIY gut health tests, and provide you with some helpful tools to start your journey to better gut health. Imagine your gut is a conveyor belt in a factory. Its movement and speed is critical for the production line to work properly. We like to call this bowel transit time or digestive motility. So the question we like to ask is this: is your conveyor belt running too fast, too slow, or just right? Let's find out with the transit time test, which gives us insights into your gut's pace with an easy at-home experiment. Bowel transit time measures the speed of your gut's conveyor belt, the time it takes for food to travel from eating to exit. It's generally considered to be a journey of between 12 to 24 hours, but we actually like to use a slightly narrower range for what we consider normal or healthy in the gut healing space. We aim for a bowel transit time of 14 to 24 hours for our clients. Why? Because we see clients with a slower or more rapid transit time struggle with symptoms like loose or very hard stools, bloating, gas, fatigue, headaches, brain fog, and just generally feeling toxic or yuck. And if your transit time is very slow, like over 72 hours, that might indicate constipation, a sluggish gut, potential bacterial imbalances, or toxins overstaying their welcome. Less than 12 hours suggests that you're on the fast track, risking poor nutrient absorption and possibly flagging more serious digestive imbalances. To conduct this at-home test, choose a food marker that's easy to spot when it makes its exit. Avoid consuming the marker for a week, then indulge in either a cob of corn, a dose of 1 to 2 tablespoons of sesame seeds or quinoa, or a large helping of beets. This will be your food marker. Make a note of the time that you eat it, and then monitor your movements until the marker reappears in the bowl. This simple yet effective method is not only practical, but also quite telling, like a sneak peek into your internal processing speed. And for accuracy, repeat the test a few times, as various factors like other foods you have eaten, hydration can also influence transit time too. Remember, we're looking for a bowel transit time of between 14 to 24 hours. Next up, let's tackle a question you might be too shy to ask. How often should you really be visiting the loo? We're delving into the frequency measurement. This isn't just about counting your trips to the bathroom. It's about understanding the rhythm of your gut. What's the ideal range for bowel motions, you ask? From 3 times a day to 3 times a week is generally considered okay, but again, we like to use a narrower range in the gut healing space. We consider ideal bowel movement frequency to be 1 to 3 times daily, once daily as a minimum. Deviating from this range can signal various gut health issues, from diarrhea, constipation, and imbalanced gut flora to malabsorption. After working with thousands of clients, we have found that the biggest drivers of bowel motility are waking in the morning and eating. Most bowel emptying occurs in the morning around breakfast, with a common second bowel emptying happening after the evening meal. If you find that your bowel empties at different times each day, so there's no rhythm or pattern for you, this can be a sign of suboptimal functioning. We commonly see a lack of rhythm with slow bowel transit time or constipation, and a common report from our clients is that they might actually be ignoring the urge to empty. I mention this because I'm terrible at listening to my body, and when I'm busy, I do this often. If this is an issue for you, then we're all going to work on this together. And here's the twist. It's not just the number of bowel motions we have daily that counts. It's also about how easy it feels. Struggling or straining is a big red flag. Feeling like it was incomplete is another. We often get clients who think that straining 2 to 3 times a week is their normal until they implement protocol recommendations and see a world of difference in frequency and a reduction in symptoms as they clear waste from their body more frequently and easily. To get a clear picture, start by keeping a poop diary for a couple of weeks. Simply make a note each time you go, and more than just the count, pay attention to the timing and ease of completeness of your bowel movements. Difficulty or discomfort can be just as telling as the frequency. By the end of this period, you'll have a personal log that can help you identify whether everything is on track or if your gut might be waving the white flag and it's time to seek further advice. Back in my university days, I ran a pondering poos program for constipated kids at a pediatric hospital. We introduced a child-friendly stool chart to parents designed to give kids a language to describe their poos using terms like rabbit droppings, corn on the cob, bunch of grapes, etc. And as simple as it was basically a cheat sheet to understand what's happening in your gut. Let's dive into the Bristol Stool Form Scale. That's the grown-up version of that enlightening chart. First published in 1997 and probably the most commonly used poop chart in the world, the Bristol Stool Form Scale is basically another way to estimate bowel transit time. The longer it takes for poop to pass through your digestive system, the more dry, hard, and compacted it becomes. But this simple chart with its lovely brown pictures can also be used to identify potential gut dysfunction in a more targeted way. Here's each of the categories and what they can tell us. Type 1 stools are separate hard lumps like nuts. It can indicate constipation, which may be the result of not enough fiber, low levels of beneficial gut bacteria, and or recent use of antibiotics. Type 2 stools are sausage-like but very lumpy and can be a symptom of IBS and long-term chronic constipation if you have this stool form often. Type 3 stools are like a sausage but with cracks in the surface, which may indicate latent constipation but can also be a normal stool form for some people. Type 4 stools are like a sausage, they're smooth and they're soft. Gold star if you're pooping a type 4. We're often working towards this with our clients. Type 5 stools are soft blobs with clear-cut edges. They may indicate slight issues with digestion of food, especially if food particles are visible, but they're typically considered a normal stool form too. Type 6 are fluffy pieces with ragged edges, so a really mushy stool. This can indicate abnormally rapid transit time and can be the result of stress, medications, laxatives, or a gut disorder, as well as not enough fiber to feed the good gut bacteria that help to regulate transit time. Finally, type 7 stools are watery with no solid pieces. This is typical diarrhea and usually results from food poisoning or gut infections, but it can also be the result of bypass or overflow diarrhea, which comes from having really chronic constipation and fecal impaction. As with all of these tests, consistency is important. A 1 of stool type may be nothing to worry about, but frequently experiencing stools that match a type 1 or 2 or a 6 or 7 may indicate problems that should be investigated with further testing. I had one of those child-friendly stool form charts I mentioned stuck to the back of my toilet door for almost a decade. Even after I moved out of my parents' house, it was still there whenever I went to visit. So while most professionals are talking about type 1 or 2, I'm still struggling to move on from corn on the cob, sausage, and porridge. Almost 20 years later. It's just way more entertaining. I also highly recommend getting a copy of the chart to help children learn about their gut health, especially if they're prone to GI symptoms. My 4-year-old loves to tell me what he sees floating in the bowl. Let's take a closer look, literally. Beyond the form of the stool, what you see when you look down in the toilet bowl can be an important indicator for gut health. Here are a few things to look for with a visual inspection. First is color. When examining your stool, color matters. Brown is best. One-off discoloration might simply be from foods or supplements you're eating, like beets, charcoal, or iron supplements, but more consistent light or dark stools may be a clue for further investigation. Light-colored stools, so a pale, clay, or gray, may indicate low iron levels, fat malabsorption, or poor bowel production. While dark stools may be the result of diet changes, supplements, lack of hydration, or an underlying gut infection. Obviously, blood in your stool, which can show as a really dark or black stool, is not a good sign and means that you should get a medical checkup. Visible mucus that looks like a slimy gel on your poop may be a clue for inflammation in your GI tract. It might also indicate other conditions such as gut infections, gluten sensitivity, or in more extreme cases, it may be a clue to look into inflammatory bowel disease. Stools that float to the surface in the toilet are most often caused by excess gas in the stool from undigested fiber, fatty stools, and even lactose intolerance. Generally, occasional floating stools are nothing to worry about, but if it becomes a consistent thing and it's associated with other IBS symptoms, it may point to an underlying issue like a loss of lactase enzymes that help you break down lactose, bacterial dysbiosis, or even a gut infection. We've already learned that not all foods are fully digestible. Foods like corn, quinoa, beets, and seeds. But for foods that should be easily digested, seeing undigested food can point towards intestinal inflammation, low levels of hydrochloric or stomach acid, pancreatic enzyme deficiency, brush border enzyme deficiency, and poor nutrient malabsorption or other gut dysfunction. This deserves a whole video alone. So how does this one work? Poop and peak. It's pretty simple. What you're looking for is consistency. So consistent color, minimal mucus and undigested food particles, and the occasional floater rather than it being a regular occurrence. Be on the lookout for any changes, and if you regularly notice anything odd, it's time to get it checked out. Ready for something a bit more aromatic? Let's talk about the sniff test. How can the smell of your stool guide you? Normal poop smells, we all know that. It's because of the bacterial byproducts, proteins, undigested plant matter, toxins, and fat being excreted. It's all completely normal. But if your bathroom suddenly smells like a sulfur mine with a special kind of rotting egg aroma, ammonia, or smells metallic, then it's time to pay attention. This test is all about noticing changes in odor. Changes could be caused by something simple like dietary changes, or it could hint at more complex issues like fat malabsorption, undigested food particles, or even a parasite like giardia, which I can personally confirm can cause rotten egg smelling poop in some people. Consistency is crucial. A one-time odor change, probably not a big deal, but if it hangs around like a bad smell, then you might want to investigate further. If these five DIY gut health tests have highlighted something is not right, what comes next? Let's put this all together. If you have gut symptoms like bloating, gas, reflux, constipation, diarrhea, abdominal pain, etc., that causes you discomfort, then please start with these free at-home tests. If you're finding that your stool transit time, frequency, consistency, and smell aren't right, then it might be time to consider functional lab testing to help uncover any potential root cause imbalances that may be contributing to your symptoms. In the next video, I'll share three of the most common root causes of GI symptoms that these DIY tests can't uncover and how we go about identifying them.